All right, we are here for some more capstone presentations. We have Corinne Pachalski and Ava Lepro, and we are going to turn it over to them to share their capstone presentation.
So we decided to do our semester long capstone on sports and the mentality behind it. Oh, wait. She's just gonna share the screen. Here we go. Share. There we go. Okay. Now this is making more sense. Right now. All right. You have to be at practice at 3 p.m., but you're 1 minute late due to your inability to get ready quickly enough. Your heart is racing, but no one notices since you stayed late talking to your teacher about problems you are unaware of. You still don't feel prepared, and you can sense this tension between you and your teammates who will have to perform sprints tomorrow as a result of your 1 minute tardiness. You return home after practice and stay up until 2 a.m. completing homework while your teacher asks you the next day, where's the homework assignment? However, you overlooked it. How could you possibly forget about it? Everything is supposed to be within your control. As a result, you sit there worrying about what else you may have neglected. Then you have a 30-minute break at noon, but it's not really a break since you utilize it to catch up on the assignment you missed because of last night's game. It's 12:10 and you return back to class within 2 hours, and then you're back on the court. Because you have to perform at practice, you must ignore everything that happened on the night before throughout the day, so that way you can perform at your highest level. You can't perform because there's someone better than you, someone competing with you, and someone in high school. Someone in high school who has just committed to being better than you. So forget the zero on your assignment. Forget the test you're not prepared for. Forget the friends you haven't seen in weeks. Forget the fight you've had with your parents. And play well, pass well, perform. And when it's finally over, you find yourself staring in the locker room mirror, trying not to cry, and you ask yourself. Many people do not understand mental illness. And when you hear the word, they stiffen up because talking about it is unsettling. You could say to yourself, oh, I've heard this before, or this doesn't apply to me. These are normal sentiments, and I used to think the same way. Well, everyone has a mental health problem. Today, I'm going to focus on mental health in athletes, since I've struggled with it myself. I'm seeing a therapist now, taking medication, and trying to think positively day by day. I try to be genuine with people on social media, but the greatest thing that stuck with me was when I sat back and wondered to myself, why it took me so long to admit it and embrace my mental illness. And I realized that the society we live in as athletes makes it so difficult for us to do so. The last thing an athlete wants is to seem weak, and we're always hearing about working hard and never giving up. So many other athletes, including myself, do not have access to sports psychologists because the issue is undervalued and schools do not have the funds due to extreme time demands and pressure that we as athletes face. We need to be more aware of how athletes are feeling across the country and consistently evaluate them. And athletes need to be more aware of their mental health in order to learn how to manage their lifestyle. I hope that all people's mental health issues are no longer stigmatized and that the world of athletics embraces individuals who are struggling. Oh, it's not going.
Okay, so this is a quote by Marty Fish. Mental health is not a very easy thing to talk about in sports. It's not perceived as very masculine. I'm sorry, I have a cold. We're so trained to be mentally tough in sports, to show weakness. To show weakness, we're told in so many words, is to deserve shame. I am here to show weakness and I am not ashamed. You have to explain it.
So the beginning of the quote talks about how mental health in sports is not the toughest. If you talk about it, basically the stigma that people have put around mental health is that it's a negative and that it makes you weaker than the people around you. And in all sports, people just want to be competitive and be better than everyone else. So to display even a single part of you that isn't better than anyone else, that we as athletes are scared to do so. But he, as the professional tennis player, wants to speak out about it and destigmatize what people have already set into place.
Yep, what's the next?
Anyway, it's not.
So I'm sure you all know who Yogi Berra is. And he said, sports are 10% physical and 90% mental. And in this day and age, you might see these roles are often reversed. For example, there are many gyms, trainers, fields, basketball courts, and so much out there that is available to for athletes to up their physical game, but there is less out there for athletes to up their mental game, and that is more important. So it's important to bring attention to this.
So I think it's important to talk about why we chose this topic. I've been growing up with sports my entire life. More recently, it's been volleyball, but I've played basketball forever, and I used to play softball. I think the two things that mainly drove my mental health down in sports was injuries. I've always been prone to ankle injuries, as a lot of other athletes are, and everything that I would work for the season, coming up to the season in the summer, and then to not be able to play in the game and to sit out really makes you overthink everything that you've done and brings down your hope about the game and your passion for the game. And then I think also COVID really impacted my mental health when it came to sports. Ever since I was a kid, I had dreamed of going professional for basketball and playing high school basketball. And then freshman year, two games into the season, I had a concussion. And then that took me out for a month. And then I had a leg injury, so I could only play like three games my freshman year, which was really disappointing to me. And then sophomore year with COVID, we were wearing masks and there were so many restrictions with basketball, I didn't play. And meanwhile, I was getting out of shape and just not doing the sport that I'd always done like almost every single day. So I think COVID really put me back into just not liking the sport that I'd always played before.
Sorry.
Don't touch it. I think you'll do it.
Probably some troubles with the clicker. So as you see, I play basketball and soccer. I've played for like probably since like elementary school. And I take soccer a lot more seriously than I do basketball. And as you can see, I'm the goalkeeper. And that position in itself requires a lot of mental toughness, because in most cases I feel the team's weight on my shoulders and I dictate whether they win or lose. And it's tough when I have to go get the ball out of the back of the net and I just think about what I could have done better. So upping my mental game is something that I have been working on, and seeing that when I up my mental game, it definitely shows physically I perform better. But similar to Corinne, I've had many setbacks in terms of injuries that, again, it's just mentally getting back into the game more than a physical thing. My sophomore year, I dislocated my elbow right before the season started for soccer, and I couldn't play at all that season, and it just took months of physical therapy. And more than anything, it was mentally, you know, seeing, not, you know, trying to envision like a normal, me being normal again, my arm being normal again, more than anything.
So we wanted to expand on not just our point of view, but athletes in the world's point of view. So we first have a video of students at Guilford High School talking about what mental health and sports is to them.
Mental health and sports is top priority. And sports is a mysterious need of attention.
Sports is important.
Mental health and sports is very important.
Mental health and sports go hand in hand.
Mental health in sports is something that needs to be taken more seriously. Mental health and
So that was just our peers' perspective on what mental health in sports means to them. And now we're going to go off of the NCAA on all three divisions and how those athletes perceive mental health.
Mental wellness to me really means being the most complete version of yourself. So obviously the physical is one part of it, but I don't think you can really succeed as well as you possibly could in athletics, academics, without truly kind of being sound mentally as well as physically.
It's hard being in college, just to be a regular student in general, but it comes down to, are you taking care of yourself? Something simple as nutrition and sleeping. If you can't take care of yourself, you can't function in a normal role as far as performing as an athlete, performing as a student. So a lot of stress comes from that.
It's overcoming that stigma and being able to come out as a student athlete and say, I'm dealing with a mental health issue and I need this help. And that's the challenge that we face as student athletes.
We're human, and mental health issues affect more than just our performance. They affect our day-to-day lives and our ability to function. So it's very important that the coaches understand that a player might be dealing with something and that that needs to be taken into account at all times.
Coaches are the first people that come into contact with the student athletes, from recruiting to just coming on campuses for visits and, you know, practices, everything. So to understand the mental wellness part of each of their student athletes and players is extremely important.
So having that opportunity as a student athlete to just be able to go into an office or to just call a friend or call your coach, whatever, to share those experiences that you maybe you're going through in a difficult time is really beneficial for that student athlete.
Just making sure that our student athletes have training, essentially. So just are more aware of the signs if a student athlete is going through something. That's something crucial that we can add to our campuses. Just awareness as a whole needs to get better because we're working towards it and we're getting somewhere with mental health as a whole, but I just feel like there's still a lot more that we can do.
So that was just actual collegiate athletes talking about it, and then we just have two short clips because all of teenagers learn from TikTok now, so these are just some ones that I found.
Athletes speak about like depression and mental health stuff. That stuff is really real. Like there's a lot of stuff that we go through as athletes that people don't like recognize or realize. And then you got these fans just talking about all this stuff on Twitter or like in a press conference like that. Like you don't know nothing about this person. So why y'all keep speaking about that? But y'all support him. Like this doesn't make sense. Like when he messes up though, it's like how much y'all hate him. It's fake. So that's why, like, you know, I don't really like when I was in Alabama, I didn't really like mess with the fans that much in the West.
One more.
Athletes speak about like depression
underneath your breath. I hear your soul.
recently there has been an extreme uprise in the amount of suicides from collegiate athletes for a very small ways. We'll never be able to understand why people sadly end their lives.
Hey girls, sorry to interrupt. Just quickly check what we did before, where the sound, where the microphone's pulling from, because we can't hear you now.
Hello?
It's a little bit better.
Hello? Hello?
There you go.
Yeah.
Kims, did you hear? Okay. Well, we'll just go on to the interview that we had.
Okay. So for our interview, we interviewed Miss Sullivan, or Coach Sullivan. She's my soccer coach, and she's also a health teacher and a gym teacher. So we thought her words were very valued. And pretty much to sum up our discussion with her, a big takeaway is that athletes these days put pressure on themselves, and there is pressure that from themselves, and there's also pressure that comes from outside sources like the fans, the coaches, the parents, but primarily it's dealing with it. And so sometimes people are so hard on themselves that they just can't take it anymore. And but Ms. Sullivan did say that players are good at boosting up one another, which is a positive takeaway, and that we're headed in the right direction. And she also did make a point that coaches are not like solely responsible for mental health among athletes, but it does. Sorry, there's a typo there. It's not solely, there are some comments and critiques that coaches make that could add to it, but it's not solely themselves. And to sum up, sorry, I can't read this. Okay. Another main point that she said, if mental health is not addressed, it does take a turn to the negative side.
Wait, I think it'll go. And that's the one.
Excuse
me. Okay, so we have a few quotes. As student athletes, we are under so much pressure, whether it's balancing our grueling schedules and academics or just always being in performance mode. With the recent tragedies in the athletic community, I felt like my story could help people or take the stigma away from the struggle. I think if you look at a bunch of people, especially college athletes, talking about their experience with it, they always mention the stigma behind it, which is probably everyone's fault as the years have gone on, about people putting in 110% every day of their lives for a sport that people will watch and they'll never know the fan that was there at the game. They'll never interact with anyone in the stadium that came to watch them. Yet the stress of that performance is unbearable.
So here's another quote. Student athletes are so glorified both by fans and teammates. It's sometimes hard to think, oh, these people struggle too. And who said this? Okay, this was said by a softball player at the University of Miami. Okay, just had to make sure. And this is a very valid point, because from the fans' point of view, athletes are just simply athletes. They're judged on their skill too harshly to be anything else but athletes. So it's hard to think that, okay, there's a human behind them. There's actual thoughts going in there, and they're human too with real life problems.
And then the last part of our presentation is going to be talking about sports psychologists, who they are and why they need to be more implicated into every athlete's life. So athletes are taught crucial skills like positive self-talk, relaxation, and life skills planning by sports psychologists who work with them to counteract the stressors that come with playing their sport. And they also may provide counseling addressing the athlete's overall mental health, as well as many mental concerns that arise along the process. I think that this generally sums up what sports psychologists can do. They're not just for people to come in and be like, hey, I'm struggling with anxiety or all of this, but whether it be from injury prevention to getting back into the game after having an injury, having them give you a pep talk, and also just skills on how to cope with the stress that comes with the sport is something that basically no high schools have, which is pretty interesting to me because you can't play a sport in college if you don't go to high school. So I think it all really starts at the base of where they start playing. And then sports psychology primarily focus on psychological training to aid in performance enhancement, and physical preparation is vital, but how athletes present themselves mentally on competition day, as well as how they maintain a mental focus throughout their performance, has a significant impact on the outcome. So like Ava was talking about before, how she's a goalie and how injury stopped her from being fully confident in her game. Basically, if let's say Guilford High School had a sports psychologist that could help her conquer the fear of getting the same injury and getting out for the same amount of days versus just going into a game and having the fear can really impact a team greatly, because one person's performance could change an entire team's outcome and vice versa. Mm-hmm.
Including a psychologist on the support staff also helps normalize and de-stigmatize mental health. De-stigmatize mental health issues among student athletes. Sports psychology has increased in prominence over the last two decades, both as an academic discipline and as a practical application. So it's a good thing that I definitely think we have a brighter future in terms of mental health and destigmatizing the negative stigma around mental health and talking about it, because as you can see, it's increased over the last two decades, but there's still many, like a lot of progress to be made, and that can be simply done by including a psychologist on the staff of a team. Recent study has revealed that many athletes, coaches, and athletic administrators are still hesitant to seek the counsel of a certified sports psychologist, even when they believe it would be beneficial. One of the main reasons for this hesitancy appears to be a lack of knowledge regarding the process and methods by which these mental skills influence performance. So there's a little bit of a lack of knowledge between coaches and like administrators. They don't know how much the mental side of things can improve your game. And so that's why we're not seeing as many sports psychologists as we would like to see. But as soon as people, administrators, coaches start understanding that upping your game starts on the mental side of things, there will be more and people will perform better.
So that's basically the end of our slideshow, but to sum everything up, with everything that's been going on with NCAA athletes and all the suicide rates going up for teams in general, I think should be more than enough reason for people to welcome it more into society and allow people, and especially athletes, to talk about it and to help them perform better as athletes and as people.
And that's a wrap. Thank you for coming.
All right. Very nice job, ladies. Yeah, you guys can stop sharing the screen if you want. I want to open it up to our audience if they have any questions.
That's
So I have a couple of questions. I don't know if you guys have watched the show Ted Lasso at all.
No.
You should. It's all about it's about soccer, but it's also it's a fascinating show. But what's interesting about it is that actually this past season was all about mental health in the sport and bringing in a sports psychologist. And the different people and how they dealt with it on the team and who was bought into it and who didn't, and actually showed, you know, one of the main characters like really needing mental health help. So it was, you know, it was really, if you kind of Google it, there was a lot of articles about how they were like, wow, just like you guys were saying, like bringing the attention to the issue of like how this is like a real problem in sports. And society in general. So I just, as you guys are going, I was like, oh my God, that's what this whole season was about. One of the things I also thought was really interesting, you guys, and you know, one day if you wanted to do some further research, one of the things that you guys brought up a lot was the correlation between an injury and then the mental health kind of break, how like that was a big point of struggle. And I thought that was interesting. You guys brought that up. Several times, and you have a question from Ms. Conklin. How can coaches incorporate mental health practices with their student athletes? Is there anything specific you two would like to see incorporated in your practices?
That's a great question, Ms. Conklin. How can coaches? I think that it kind of has to be from the start. I think that coaches and their athletes need to have like a connection that's more than just I'm your coach. It has to be like a personable connection, and I think that starts from like right away, like within like a first tryout or practice or whatever, to let people know that they're there for them, like more than just a coach. Like if you need to talk to me or whatever, stuff like that. I think it's just being there on a personal level. So when hard times do come, you have someone to turn to, and it doesn't have to be turning to them as a coach. It can be someone that you can turn to, and that kind of opens up doors to be there for you mentally before you get on the field.
I also think it's important to know that, like, especially in high school, like, playing one softball game or one basketball game or one volleyball is not playing at the Olympics. And I think some coaches that I've played with really think that, oh no, you miss one shot, a million people are going to judge you for it. I think that a lot of people are taught like that, and they overstress the idea of a girls' basketball team or a boys' football team. I think it's just a sport in the end, and people do it because they like it. Like, I think as a kid, the reason why I played basketball forever was because I enjoyed it and I loved having fun with it. So I think fun is also an important factor of it.
Mm-hmm. Nice. So stepping away from what you researched and what you guys looked into for a moment, what I'd like you each to answer as you just did, what have you learned about yourself as a learner from doing a capstone project?
I'll go first. I have no more nails to pick. me and Amy probably should never do a presentation together again. That's my outcome of this, but I think it. I think I've learned a lot about, like, especially in March, there were 5 athletes in like 5 days that committed suicide, and so that sparked my interest immediately. Not even going into this in January did I know that that was going to happen, but it was really interesting to read about that because the people that then started to spread awareness just after that happened, instead of it being the duration of the 6 months that I worked at it, especially from March to now, there's been a spark of people talking about it. So I think it's interesting to see that once something drastic as 5 suicides in NCAA sports changes everyone's opinion on it. It's interesting.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. One thing I've learned is to do a little bit of a better job managing my time and maybe like spend more time prepping. those are just things that I've taken away from this and what she said.
Yeah, what would you say is the most positive outcome of having done a capstone presentation? Your most positive takeaway?
My most positive takeaway would probably be getting further knowledge on a topic that's like applicable to me. And I just like, sometimes you do projects and stuff about like stuff you're not that interested about, but I'm happy that I was able to present and learn more about sports psychology, the mental side of sports.
Yeah. Great. Same question.
Same question. What was the question?
Your most positive takeaway from doing a capstone.
My most positive takeaway? Probably the same thing, but I don't know. In the past 6 months, I've decided I'm going to play basketball again. I don't know if that's
okay. All right.
Well, I don't know if it's correlated, but
hey, we won't know. All right. Thank you guys for joining us. This is Topanga Corso, and this is her capstone project.
Hello. My name is Topanga, and this is my presentation. I chose to study filmmaking for sports because my whole life I've been going to my brother's basketball games, and my mom's like made me always like film clips of him. So I started to like enjoy doing that. So then I became interested. I film clips like, and I edit them, and I used to use iMovie. And then I took a digital photography class here, and I moved into Final Cut Pro from the Sarifa. So that's kind of a big help here. It was a huge learning experience for me to learn Final Cut Pro because it's like it really like advanced from iMovie. So yeah, it's important to me because I like to bring the aspect of art into the sports filming because it's like kind of like a creative outlet. I could do my own thing, and I could like the music kind of helps too, like tying in music and art and like my own design. Like I enjoy it a lot. So the first kind of step after like getting the clips and stuff is editing. And when I edit, I move in all the clips that I had filmed from the games that I went to, and I move it into a program. This is Final Cut Pro. And I go through like the hours of game footage, and I take the best clips out, or like clips I think would make a good film, and then I start to edit them by like just cutting it and making it go with the music. And some new learnings I learned through studying this: I would watch a lot of YouTube tutorials because it is like a video, so it's kind of like it helps because it's like I'm watching something visually. And so there's a lot of good like tutorials out there. So I just would follow them. And a new technique that I learned is keyframing. And keyframing is when like you like cut out more of the person or like a ball or something in the shot, and you like make it move outside the clip. And it's in one of the videos that I'm gonna show, and I'll point it out. Another thing that I learned to do from a tutorial was making a checklist before some of the games of like what angles I wanna get and like different shots and like new techniques. Like I just make a checklist. So here's the link to the videos. And throughout like this journey, I made a whole YouTube channel, and I've posted all the videos to this channel. And I've been to like so many games. I went to like most of the lacrosse games and a lot of the basketball ones. So I'm just gonna start with this eventually I want to like branch out and do like other schools and other towns, like maybe like other job opportunities like aside from sports, but I really am interested in the sports because of the way the music kind of goes with the video.
The sound. We'll see. Okay. This video will help us.
Okay.
There's no sound?
No. It says there's Okay, 1 second, we're just getting the sound.
I know, I turned on the wall, I turned it up.
Some struggles that I came across while like making all these videos was the amount of time it takes to like go through the footage after I just came back from like the game. So I kind of have to watch the game like multiple times, which is like gets tedious, but I enjoy it because I like looking for like the perfect clip, but like,
should be. Yeah. Go ahead.
Touch Where's it. The remote?
Oh yeah, I don't know where the remote is. Sound on that projector. Although we heard the buzzing.
Yeah. Another thing, my favorite games to film, I would say, are basketball games, just because my whole life I've been going to basketball games because of my brother. And I just like basketball is really like high intensity, and it's like you're in like a gym, and it's like it's really interesting to me. So I find it like entertaining, and I like to like show
it. Like to end your sound,
isn't it? I think so.
Yeah, it says that it's not muted. Here, can we? It says there's like a caution.
You can go out of your. Out of your presence, like minimize and go right to your YouTube channel and yeah. directly from there.
Here, let's hold on.
Well, it went to another channel.
Yeah,
it was a lane.
Is any sound?
Hold on, let's see.
We could always just watch it on there. But...
Hold it to the right.
I can hear it through my computer. Hold on.
Can you hear it?
And the camera that I use, I used to film on my iPhone, which does like pretty decent quality, but I recently was like, I've always had a camera, but I never really used it for the sports videos, but for Christmas, my mom and dad got me a new lens. So for my camera, so like I use that zoom lens, like for lacrosse and stuff, with basketball, I could use like a small camera, but I use a Canon Rebel, which is like a pretty good camera. I want to start researching like different cameras and like what makes
it better. So I can hear it. I use it this all the time.
And that HDMI cable?
Well, yeah.
You just use it for steam lens.
Right.
It could be this projector. So if
also, want,
we can move to back there.
Or we can just want me to just I'll just unplug it and turn it around so people can at least see it.
Yeah.
Is that work?
Yeah.
So they can at least see in here. Mm-hmm. Is that a good enough angle-ish? I'll make it like big screen. Yep.
Another thing I wanted to touch on before you watch the video is the camera angles. I focused a lot throughout my research on like different angles that I could use instead of like sitting in one spot throughout a game and just kind of filming the whole game. So I learned that like you should make a checklist of like the three best shots to get, and that the first one is like an establishing shot, like of the whole like arena or gym, and then close-up shots, which are like kind of like emotional and like add like emotion to the video, and then action shots, and these shots are like what kind of go in the beat drops and like add to it, so in the video you can see that.
Ready?
I'm glad you shared that. I was gonna ask about that now.
Yeah. Father God, I just want to live life. Lamborghini loud pipes. Remember all the trial nights. Pull up in the poster guys. 100,000 on me, yikes. Shadow was too sloppy. She was too sloppy. I had to roll the dice. He think that I'm Luminati because of my father. Pull up in poster guys. Better than this popping. You got nothing. You ain't do it right. Traveling across the country. I can get mad and say you get who or not. Could make a get a Kruger fight. You was a your cruiser though. I was born to be what I'm going to born. The raindrops on me like a storm on raindrop. He look at my charm, but I'm on it. The devil keep trying to come conquer me. Smoking two in a font to leave. Dropping the deuce in the purely peace. I don't got time for no foolery. I'm about to go drop on some jewelry. Hey, I'ma tell you, look. Son. Look, fame blowing all you money. Fame. Maintain, gotta keep 100 coming. Woo. Ain't no pain like the name with no money. Pain. I ain't going out sad for sad. Learn my lesson with the last one. Learn my lesson. Cody, stop the bad boy. The bad bitch. For some cash, boy. She don't gotta know the got a landlord. She just laying on the landlord. Woo. All they be paying for. Papa, that's an outdoor. Run, you be a cowboy. Grind me, they some cowboy. Whole body. whole style, boy. Copy the flow, give it now, boy. Do not play with the cake. I pull up and hop in the dirty rainbows. Gonna out the face. I'm getting this money, I'm getting paid. I jib out a mansion. On the back of the bench, no panties. But my money look demanding. Come on. All the mansion, the pool got expanded. Put that money on your koofy like dancing. Spot it too hot, then put the lift on the moat. Everybody too hot, shot it, them. Them caught a little bot. Don't know nothing about it. Got it too hot, then put the lift on the moat. Everybody too hot, shot it, shot it, little bot. Don't call them a bot. Don't know nothing about it. Got it too hot, then put the lift on the moat. Everybody too hot. Cause they not gon' rob me. Pound of cookie in the backstage of Jimmy Fallon. 500,000 cash backstage of Ellen White.
So you, can I ask you that?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So you added all the music. Mm-hmm. You had to go back and look at all your video. And then you took parts of it, edited it, right? Mm-hmm. And put it in this, and you added the music?
Yeah. And I like made it like go, yeah, I added like some, I've always kind of known how to do like adding like different things, but in the video on Bada Show, there's like a lot more, like I kind of spent like a night like just researching techniques and like new like layovers I could add. So that was kind of just like a montage of like, that's like a highlight reel. But I tried to make this one, the Bada Show, a little more like entertaining, kind of like for Instagram, because like there's different styles of videos. Here's this. You wanna? Yeah, I'll show that one too. That one isn't really sports, but that also kind of is like. I'll go back to that because that was right there. That's a keyframe, so it kind of takes one shot, and then it like it. I cut like his head out of the shot, so it like.
With new sight, angel delight. Still outside, still outside, still outside, still outside. Came in college, ten of them, stay outside. And I'm still outside, I'm still outside, still outside. Let's get right, let's get right, let's get right, let's get right. Subject to memes, I signed a few. I polished their dreams. An angel on earth, come under my wing. And I'm bringing your publishers. They publish the headlines and say the wrong things. I treat your Lord and Savior like renters insurance. You know what I mean? Body the boom. I body the boom. I body the bean. I need a new girl. My old one was mean. I had to let go. Forgave all them evils that came to my shows. I channeled them back. Down on the boat. I channeled your chest. I channeled the turbulence. Came with the life. I gathered my sinners and asked them for might. Let's get right, let's get right, let's get right. Ain't on sight, it's on sight. I don't know you, it's on sight. I don't know you, hey. I'm on my on channel 5, I don't channel 10 till it go time. Used to throw up my uncle's spaghetti. Been taught to dance since before I was ready. Back when my mama told me that I was challenged. They single black women, you know that she petty. I turned a heavy heart to $2 million. I put that in totals, reverse out of this.
Yeah, I drink a booze for breakfast, an intro for dessert. Somebody order pancakes, I just sip the scissor. That right there could drive a sane man bizarre. Not to worry, Mr. Ace of the Hills, back to Wizard.
So that one, I tried to make it a little more, like, entertaining and, like, fast-paced. But, so this is, I'll show a basketball one, and then I'll show for the last one. One of the...
Is that the one Kate wanted?
Yeah. Okay, well, this is the one of the basketball ones. We don't have to watch them.
All's my life, I has to fight. All's my life, hard times like God, bad trips like God.
Nazareth. I'm f***ed up, homie, you f***ed up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Huh? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. Bahamasabi be looking at you from the face down. Or Mac 11 need the boom with the face down. Skimming, and let me tell you about my life. Painkillers only put me in the twilight. A pretty Benjamin is the highlight. I tell my mama I love her, but this what I like. Lord knows. 20 of them in my Chevy. Tell them all to come and get me. Reaping everything I sow. So my karma come in heaven. No preliminary hearings on my record. I'm a get gangsta in silence for the record. Tell the world I knew it's too late. Boys and girls, I think I'm going great. Trying to side my face is all day. My knees getting weak and my gun might blow, but we gon' be alright, right? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Huh? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. What you want? You a house, you a car, 40 acres and a mule, a piano, a guitar, anything. See, my name is Lucy, I'm your dog. Motherfucker, you can live at the mall. I can see the evil, I can tell it. I know it's illegal. I don't think about it. I deposit every other zero. Thinking of my partner, put the candy, painting on a Rico. Digging in my pocket, in a profit, big enough to feed you. Worried in my logic, get another dollar just to keep you in the presence of your Chico. I don't talk about it, be about it. Every day I seek you. If I got it, then you know you got it. Heaven, I can reach you. Pet dog, pet dog, pet dog, my dog, that's all. Be back in chat, I trap the bag for y'all. I rap, I black on tracks, so rest assured. My rights, my wrongs, I write till I'm right with God. When you know, we've been hurt, been down before.
There's some that we didn't win, but I just did a montage of like a couple games. So that's like, it kind of added it. But, so I'll show the Spirit Week one.
Google Fi, a phone plan by Google. Save.
Okay, this is the Spirit Week one. It was like in the beginning of the year. And a lot of like people that, yeah.
I'll be fine once again.
what you know about night, there is nothing. You don't really care about the trials of tomorrow. Rather lay awake in the bed full of sorrow.
I'm on the pursuit of happiness, and I know everything is shining, always gonna be gold. I'll be fine once again. I'll be good.
Jacob Halsema helped me with some of the footage, like in the boarding room and stuff.
Oh, I was gonna say,
and on the bus and stuff.
Is there another one, or are we back to the presentation?
We're back to the presentation.
Okay, there's so, blocks back in.
Well, there's no more slides, but okay. I just want to like close it
out. Yeah.
What I take away from all these videos is that like I actually became really interested in it, because at first it started out of just kind of filming my brother and like going to his basketball tournaments, and then it turned into like helping like other kids and stuff and like doing like their videos. So I've like really been interested in it. So I'm excited to like pursue it, hopefully in the future with like a business or something. And like dance studios have like reached out to do like dance videos too, and like hair salons in Guilford. So like I'm gonna try and like stay local and like just film around town. So I'm excited about that.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Okay, I know we've asked a few throughout. Go ahead.
Why Final Cut Pro? What is it about that?
It's actually Final Cut Pro is, it's like the upgrade from iMovie, which is built into like Apple products. And I've used that like all the way up to taking digital cinematography. And in digital cinematography at the school, Mr. Ripa teaches us Final Cut Pro. So it's like a lot more, there's way more like edits and effects you could use, and like it just widens like the whole like editing thing. So I like made it my goal to learn it like in the past years. So I've asked like Mr. Ripa a lot of questions, and like he's helped me out a lot. So he's actually my mentor. So he's helped me a lot.
That's awesome. Thank
you. Any other questions?
So with all these people that you film, like, how do you get the word out, like where you put it, or you know, like market it? Like,
well, I have an Instagram, which I originally started posting the videos to my brother, and then people like from the school would just like follow it. I don't know, because my brother, I don't know. And so then I don't really remember what the first video I did. I think I filmed one of the basketball games because he was on the team and like the boys were in the back. Like, and so then I was like, maybe I'll just make a whole video. My friends kind of encouraged me to just make it for the team.
Right.
So I did like a first basketball one this year for the whole team, and I posted it, and like it did really well. And like
people liked it. So then I was doing football once too, but I don't have those on the channel because that was kind of like earlier before I started the capstone. So I wanted to just keep this for like what I worked on during the capstone, but on the channel, I'm going to like post all the football ones too. So yeah, they're on my Instagram.
Well, and I can also appreciate the importance of being clear about what your objective is, because if you wanted to do a whole montage of spelling scene, you know, you could use all the things around you, but your focus is there. But if you're talking about appealing to a grander audience, you don't get stuck on one group of kids.
Yeah.
Like, you have such a diverse group that you're using that you're really taking samples from, and it appeals to more people. You know
what
I mean?
For the Spirit Week one, I really wanted to try to get like a majority of the school in it, just because as much as I could, because it was hard because obviously I was in school, but like during my free periods or like lunch and stuff, I'd go around and ask people. And then as the week went on, people started to hear about it, and they're like, oh, you're filming, they'd come up to me. And a lot of people, it's a big emotional challenge, I guess, going up to people. It's kind of a challenge for myself, just asking people if I could film them for a clip, and they didn't really know. So I thank the school for a lot of my peers for being in the videos and stuff.
It's awesome.
So what did you learn about yourself as a learner doing a capstone project?
Well, I've done a capstone last year, and I feel like with that one, I really researched into reading actual articles, and with this one, I've watched things, which I feel like it's not really a big deal, but it changed the whole learning process, because there's such a wider audience of people on YouTube and stuff who know exactly what I want. I just would search those videos, and I learned that I'm more of a visual person, and learning through seeing how people edit the videos and how I could put my own twist on it with the visual aspect. So I feel the YouTube videos have helped me a lot.
Any other questions?
I have just a comment. I've done a lot of editing of videos.
Oh, really?
For the capstone projects when they were remote.
Mm-hmm.
So I know how intense it is.
Yeah.
And I didn't do nearly any effects. So they were awesome. I just know the concentration and what it takes to know exactly where to cut something.
The biggest challenge is, I would say, keep going through the games and stuff. That's a huge challenge, because it's attention span isn't that long to keep watching the same thing over and over again. That's why I like to add new effects, add new music, and it changes the whole thing, because constantly I'm asking myself what I could do next, what's the next edit I could do, or the next song, or what people want to see. But also making it myself, because there is a lot of Instagram highlight reel accounts for sports, and I feel if I put my own twist on them, it kind of changes it. Yeah.
Good job. Great job.
Thank you.
All right. So since you're visual, here you can read.
Thank you.
That was awesome.
Thank you.